Tried all the tricks they teach you about how to do this and not have bile up against the back of your throat and haven't found a trick that works yet. I'm imagining all of you naked. I don't know what that's doing to your stomach, but it ain't settling mine. I found if I do biography, bile goes back where it belongs. I am from Libby, Montana. How many of you have been to Libby? Awesome. How many have been there on purpose? Three hands. Tourism's our future. Yeehaw. Libby looks a lot like Nelson or Preston or Castlegar or Cranbrook, which is our sister city. We have a deep history in forestry and mining. Does that sound familiar? We share a lot of things, including the river that runs through the home of the Libby loggers. The river is the Kootenai. So we share a lot of things, including, oh, dang it. We share a lot of environmental things. The animals that we have, the grizzly bear population we have is the southern tip of body of grizzly bear population that largely lives in British Columbia. We have northern caribou that wander through our area once in a while, but they mostly live here. We share a lot of things. We also share a legacy. Oh, dang. This is what our past looked like. Does that look familiar? I was walking down the hall here, and what do you know? You've got the same crap hanging on your wall. It's not crap, it's our history. It's wonderful history, but our history has some pretty ugly things in it if you aren't from where we live. Because the people that formed our communities 100 years ago, my family landed in Libya in 1904, and this is what it looked like in forestry. The timber baron days, and they were real. In fact, the family that started Libby, Montana, started over in Maine, whacked the trees down to build Boston, moved to Michigan, whacked the trees down to build Detroit, moved to Minnesota, whacked the trees down to build the Twin Cities, and at the end of the 1800s, they needed a new patch of trees. The Great Northern Railroad had just been built, so they loaded the sawmill and the town up on the brand new railroad, offloaded in northwest Montana, and started whacking trees down. Interestingly enough, at the end of their journey through our area, they noticed that they were running out of trees. And the next stop was going to be the Pacific Ocean. So they changed some of their practices. In our area, in fact, logging doesn't look like it used to look. In fact, our area is studied because of some foresters that work for the J. Neal's Lumber Company and studied by the World Commission on Forests. The reason they study it is because we had a couple of foresters that developed a 200-year management plan for our area. They were, for the first time ever, they were planting instead of just cutting and running, because they knew if they did a good job of taking care of the forest, they would do a good job of taking care of future generations in that spot. That hadn't happened before. But we're really proud of that legacy. Things have changed. My part of the legacy, by the way, is I was a timber faller. I don't have to tell you the things that have changed in our industry. I looked at the college back there, the Selkirk College, and you can go get a logging degree of some kind now. Good heavens. It looks nothing like it did 30 or 40 years ago. In fact, when people call this a sunset industry, they have no idea what's changing and what's required now in modern forestry. And a lot of times when people talk about our industry, they say, well, technology is taking your jobs away. That's your real problem. It's not these other things. It's not supply. It's technology. Six people can run a sawmill that used to take 56. Well, the Wood Engineering Lab down in Portland did a study on how many jobs per board foot it takes to produce this stuff. And the jobs per board foot has remained static since the 1950s. And the reason it's remained static is because we're still using the same number of people. We're just not doing the same kind of jobs. We're not out on the ground. We're in associate industries. We now have GPS technology we didn't have before, and that takes people. We have computer technologies that we didn't have before, and that takes people. We have environmental technologies that we didn't have before, and that takes people. The number of people per board foot has remained static since the 50s, but our jobs have changed. One of the biggest changes is we do plant. So I left home, I graduated from Libby Senior High School as a Libby logger with a proud heritage of stewardship, I thought, and conservation. But I went to college in Portland, Oregon, and it didn't take very long being in school to figure out the kids I was going to school with didn't look at me as a steward. They looked at me as an axe murdering Neanderthal. According to them, I was killing the trees. But one of the summers when I was home murdering trees, I met my wife, PJ, which isn't entirely true. She wasn't my wife when I met her, although I tried that. I've been in a logging camp up in the Yak a couple of weeks, and I went to town, and there she was. She had a tube top and a tan, and I said, "You're my wife." She wasn't. She's a pretty strong-willed woman, and I'm still scarfing that stupid remark. We fell in love, got married, I moved to Portland to go to college together, and we learned that we had accidentally manufactured a child. We had one in the oven. We learned that it took a whole lot more logging to go to school when there were two going on three of us, so we moved from Portland to Spokane. I enrolled at Gonzaga. I enrolled there because it was 3.5 hours from home. I could go to school Monday through Thursday and Friday, Saturday, Sunday, go home and log. On one of those weekends home, we accidentally manufactured another child. And PJ said, "Something has got to stop." So I quit school. We got our priorities straight. We actually didn't quit either one very good. It took 10 years and 4 kids, but we made it through Gonzaga. We got a Bachelor of Science in Civil Engineering and a Master's in Business Administration. Got a job with a construction company in Spokane, a city of 250,000. We were on our career ladder to yuppiedom. And one night we were watching the kids play out in the yard, and we noticed two really important things. They're playing inside a chain link fence inside a city. And to this day, we're perpetually pleased that there are hundreds of millions of Americans and Canadians that want to call urban areas their home. We're glad they do. We stayed up all night and talked about what we wanted for us and our kids. And we made what for us was a quality of life decision. We wanted to raise our kids in the luxury of the rural environment that I had grown up in. So in February of 1984, we packed our crap in a U-Haul and we went back to Montana. We were the only loaded U-Haul going into Montana in February. And we went back, joined the family logging company. The family logging company, our iteration of Vincent Logging, was rope building and forestry, started by mom and dad in the mid-60s. And this probably sounds familiar. In the early days of the company, on weekends, mom and us kids had strapped coveralls on and hand dad wrenches. The goal was to have the machinery operating on Monday morning when dad hit the brush with the crew and mom hit the office attached to the house. They ultimately grew the operation to include 65 other families. And Libby, that's a big outfit. It's also an isolated area, so a lot of them were cousins, you know how that works. My dad once said, "That's why rural people wave. You just never know. That might be some DNA going by." The 65 included mom and dad's 4 boys. I am the second of 4. We lost mom a while ago, and a couple years ago we lost dad. So now my wife at my side as we try to figure out what we're going to have to hand to the next generation. This is the next generation. This is my clump. I have 4 kids. I have 11 grandkids. They love rural America. They'd like to be able to continue to call their rural area their home. And by the way, that's the biggest thing I think we share. We share a culture that you can drive across the border between the states and here, and it's the same culture inhabits our communities. That's the culture I want to raise my family in. Hardworking, hard playing, community oriented, family oriented, school oriented, church oriented people still live in Castlegar and in Fruitvale and in Libby. That's what I wanted to raise my kids in, and that's what I'd like if my kids choose, I'd like to have available for them. And if everything was okay, I'd be home doing what I do in the place I like to do it with the most awesome mate on earth, but something went wrong in Libby. Something has gone wrong in a lot of our rural communities. And I used to, first time we met, Ken, I talked about the fact that it was going crazy down south of the border, and you guys need to watch. Because I have a lot of friends up in Canada. And usually crazy would follow. It'd take about 10 years for it to manifest on there and then perk across the border. It doesn't take 10 years anymore. Crazy is happening down there, and with the internet and communication, it's happening very quickly here. And it started to go wrong down south about almost 30 years ago now. And what I want to talk with you about is what I think is going on. Something is wrong in our resource communities. We're here because of timber, but as John said, I talked to it's rural areas and natural resource commodity production in both of our industrialized countries. And we've got a problem. I want to talk with you about where I think we are, how I think we got there, what I think we can do about it, and why after almost 30 years of being on the stump, I have more hope today than I did when I first started speaking out. Where are we? We're having what I call a collision of visions. We're having that collision with the rest of our society. America has about 80% of the public that lives in our urban areas. Canada has even more. A larger percentage of your population lives in urban areas. And our people in both of our countries have had two things for the last 50 years that humans have never had before: time and money. And what have they been doing with their 2-week summer vacation? They've been blowing out of places like Seattle and Vancouver and Chicago and Los Angeles and coming to our rural areas and communing with us. And what do you know? They've been falling in love. And who could blame them? Where you live looks nothing like Vancouver. Looks nothing like the south side of Chicago or Los Angeles. In fact, they thought where you live was already gone. They get 200 channels of bad news. And here they drive just a few hours outside of Vancouver, and there it is outside their car window. Beautiful areas. Clean air, clean water, abundant wildlife. Good heavens, the last best parts of our nation have not been destroyed yet. And they fall in love. And we don't blame them. How many of you love the environment? That's part of why we live here. They fall in love with what they think we are. But then at the end of the 2 weeks, they have to go home. And when they leave with a desire. And it's a desire we understand. It's a desire to protect. They want to save what they perceive to be the last best places. And they start fighting through regulatory reform, through judicial activism, legislative activism. They start imprinting their version of protection on top of us. And sadly, their vision for the last best places has one fatal flaw. There's no provision in it for the last best people. And if they don't change that, the very thing they want to protect is going to pay the price of their protection. Because in both of our countries, the policy that comes out of our governmental regimes has nothing to do with reality. It has everything to do with the public's perception of reality. And the public's perception of our realities has some problems. I'm going to go through this really quick because you live in a forested area, but there it is. There's a healthy forest. When they come visit us in the summer, they see that and they think, oh my heavens, cheap picture postcard mentality. That's healthy, that's beautiful, it's been that way forever. Has it been? No, if they were to visit us 15,000 years ago, it wouldn't look like that. It would look like a mile of ice. The ice is gone now. By the way, I don't argue with people about global warming. It's warmed up, and it's probably not cow farts that did it. But the ice is gone, and when the ice left, the First Nations people moved in, and they started managing the forest. I encourage all of you to read 1491, a book by Charles Mann, about what was here before Columbus landed. And for almost 15,000 years, Native Americans have been managing our forest. This forest that they see there that they think is healthy hasn't always looked like that. When white man first came to the Kootenai country where I lived, there were 50 to 60 trees to the forested acre because they managed it. The trees weren't their friends. The ungulates they ate didn't eat the trees. They ate grass. It was hard to travel through trees. They couldn't see their prey, they couldn't see their enemies, so they burned. Religiously, they burned. They burned my valley every 10 to 12 years. For thousands of years, they did that. So when white man came, 50 or 60 trees to the acre is what they visited. This is not 50 or 60 trees to the acre. This is 500 to 600 trees to the acre. And on the Kootenai, every pine tree sucks 200 to 300 gallons of water out of the ground a day. That's a lot of water pumps. So when we have a normal water year, we have a forest that's expressing stress because there are too many of them. And we end up with this. That's the drainage behind my house, and those red trees are dead trees. You know what that's all about? And yes, it's a natural cycle of disease, but it's going through unnaturally quick and unnaturally heavy. For the first time in recorded history, the mortality in our forest is outstripping the growth. And it's because the bugs have come in, the trees are stressed, and the bugs are winning. Don't need to tell you about that. Could we do something about it? Yeah. This is an overstocked forest. 192 million acres in the U.S. West looks like this. What we could be doing is turning it into this. Removing some of those pieces of fuel, sending them the right log to the right place, turning that stuff into the furniture or the biomass or the 2x4s that society consumes, and then we could introduce low ground hugging fire back into the ecosystem to grow things like huckleberry patches for the grizzly bears. But when you have too much fuel, you end up with fuel ladders. You light that controlled burn, and the controlled burn climbs up into the canopy of the trees, and you end up with Fort McMurray. That's not a sustainable fire. That's not doing good ground-hugging, cool fire things, like popping the seat or the cones of the heat-sensitive lodgepole pine and invigorating the topsoil. We have fires that are burning so hot in Montana that the clay soils are being fired into ceramics. It's going to take eons to grow our children's forest because we're pretending. After 200 years of removing the Native American management and letting nature just grow unmanaged, that nature can weigh in and be benign. It's not benign. That is not a Photoshop picture. You've probably seen that. That's the Bitterroot River, and that was a bad day for that elk. It's also a bad day for the North Fork of the Flathead. I'll tell you what, it's really tough to sell postcards when that's the backdrop. There's got to be a better way. Something is wrong. My industry's social license to operate, however, was being debated while our forest health issue was going south. And we lost that debate. And our social license to operate is another thing that we share. We only operate with the consent of the public. If they tell you to quit operating in the interior, guess what? You're going to quit operating. You've got to have their consent. It's their land. So you've got to have a license from them in order to operate. We lost our license. We're crossing, because of that, the thin line between environmental sensitivity and environmental insanity. There's a thin line there, and we're not alone. It's not just timber that we're crossing the line. Something's wrong when professional resource managers of all kinds are losing or abdicating their ability to manage to professional litigants whose agenda in court has more to do with greed, power control, and social engineering than it does environmental stewardship. Something's wrong when the public is rightly concerned about the environment but willing to get important information on this important subject from such noted experts as Dr. Leonardo DiCaprio. Good God, the guy pretends for a living. Dr. Woody Harrelson, did you see him hanging from the Golden Gate Bridge last year? CNN was out there interviewing him on Redwood Forestry like he's an expert. He is a pot-smoking loon. And Dr. Ted Turner, just because he wants to own the stinking satellite, that doesn't make him an expert on whatever bounces off of it. But when they spew their misinformation, disinformation, pseudoscience, half-truths, and an unknowing public, and when the media prints that crap as the truth, that's the reality we base our policy on. And what kind of lens does society have to run this stuff through to test it for the truth? They've got a tsunami of information coming at them. They have your lens? No. They have 50 years of Bambi under their belt. They think before you showed up in places like Nelson, wolves were raising orphaned rabbits in a sea of old growth. They have no idea that in the real world the wolf eats the rabbit. They don't have a party right after that. But they've been sold the Disney-esque ecotopia that has never and will never exist. And I don't blame them. And now they've even perfected that argument. It's even more damaging than it used to be. It used to be that nature was good and man was bad. Of course it is. 20-minute mark of every single Disney movie, the bad actor shows up. The destroyer of harmony, the destroyer of balance is man. But the last 10, 15 years, how many of you watched Avatar? Good heaven, Fern Gully, hoot, although it's not just any man that's truly evil, it's capitalist humans that are really the problem. And what a danger that is for the earth. What they fail to understand is that economy and ecology come from the same Greek root word, oikos. It means house. The inside of our house is our economy. The outside's our ecology. They're joined at the hip. You beat one up, the other pays the price. If we don't have a healthy environment in our rural areas, we can't grow a healthy, sustainable economy. But if we don't have a healthy, vigorous, profit-making economy, we don't have the economic luxury of taking care of the environment. And I'm afraid down south of the border, what we're growing accustomed to and what we seem to be satisfied with is driving that cycle in the wrong direction, because we want to consume. We are the most consumptive society on earth. It's just production we don't like. We love our roads. We'd like them to be wide and smooth. It's just moving the dirt that we're opposed to. We like gravel on our driveway. We just don't like rocks being crushed. We love cheap gas at the pump. It's just drilling that sucks. We love our wood. It's stumps that suck. There's a complete disconnect. And what we threaten to become, I think, is the biggest threat to the global environment through misguided lockup of our own. We seem more than willing to import raw products from developing countries that are long on resources, long on population, and short on cash, import products from them and export the environmental burdens of production to people who can't afford it. They'll send us our crap using methods we quit using 30 years ago, and we'll call it green because we don't have to look at it. There's a thin line between environmental sensitivity and environmental insanity, and we're crossing it. How did we get there? I go back to the 60s. How many of you remember the 60s?
This is bad.
That's bad. My generation has a problem with the 60s. We remember part of 1967. We might not have inhaled, but we ate the entire plate of brownies. That's what happened in the 60s. And now we're in leadership. Woo! The most important thing that happened in the 60s, I think, though, is we got television. And we pushed the boob tube in the living room close enough to the dining room so we could watch Walter Cronkite while we ate. And for the first time in human history, you didn't have to live someplace to know what was happening there in real time. I was a kid in Montana when the Cuyahoga River caught on fire and burned for a week through Cleveland. Do you remember that? I do. I wasn't very old, but I remember looking at the tube thinking, rivers should not burn their bridges up. That's awful. You didn't have to live in Pennsylvania to know that Lake Erie was dying. We got to watch the fish swim the wrong side up every night. You didn't have to live in Los Angeles to know their air was turning purple. Then from the eyeballs of a humanoid in a spaceship almost to the moon, we got to see our little blue ball called Earth from a distance. It was kind of bobbing along in blackness. What happened in the 60s is we figured out we have one planet, we're only getting one planet, and some of the stuff we were doing to it needed to stop. We joined in Factor and Spirit, an environmental social movement, a movement designed to get laws on the books to take care of home. If a group didn't exist, we started one. I was a leader the first Earth Day in Libby, Montana. I was in middle school and we picked up crap in the creek going by the school. Patrick Moore from British Columbia, he was going to UBC getting his forest ecology degree, and he and a friend didn't like the atom bomb dropping on the Bikini Atoll. So they started Greenpeace. Good, well-intended groups designed to get laws on the books to take care of home, Earth, our planet. And they did a good job. Down in the States, we got a couple dozen pieces of legislation, good, well-intended pieces, like the Clean Air Act and Clean Water Act and Endangered Species Act, and good, well-intended laws. But the movement and the policy that came out of it are 30, 40, some almost 50 years old, and they're showing their age. The policies are being misused in the real world. They're having perverse reactions in the real world. They're not working anymore. They've been changed and bastardized until they don't even resemble what they're intended to be. And the movement itself, well, the movement's alive. The movements in the Selkirk College where people are learning how to be a logger of the future. It's in every single company, particularly the small companies that have to be innovative because they don't have volume. That's where the movement learned to market wasn't stewardship and conservation. The product some of them learned to market was fear. They learned they could scare people out of $20 a year if they just had the right message. And they become experts at marketing that fear. They're very, very, very good at what they do. They turned what was a social movement into a business that is completely dependent upon conflict, crisis, and fear. And they still use things like the tube, and they boil the very complex issues that surround places like Nelson and forestry, they boil it into really easy choices for a very concerned public. Questions, and boil them into two pretty easy choices for the public. When they're discussing things like oil and gas, what's the visual backdrop they give for the 20-second soundbite where they talk about oil development? It's the Exxon Valdez, or it's the BP oil spill in the Gulf? It's dead birds bobbing in the Gulf of Mexico? That's the first 20-second soundbite. The guy who doesn't like it, he gets to stand by the Everglades with a flag in one hand, bald eagle in the other, and says, all I want is clean air and water for my children, and points out that everybody in that last soundbite are greedy corporate bastards intent on profit alone. And that's the end of the newscast, and society gets to pick. You want the dead black birds bobbing in the ocean? No. Every industry is treated the same. They go to Montana. Have anybody ever been to Butte, Montana? Berkeley Pit, one of the worst mistakes we made in mining. Dead birds bobbing in a settling pond, Orange River's coming up. It was made 100 years ago. But that's mining in the 22nd soundbite. The guy who doesn't like it stands in front of the Continental Divide, flag in one hand, bald eagle in the other. All they want is clean air and water for his children. America gets to pick. How about animal agriculture? Anybody here have cattle? How many of you have seen that black and white spotted cow in Northern California with the forklift through the side getting drugged through manure? That's animal agriculture. And the guy who doesn't like it is Wayne Pacelli with the Humane Society, and he's petting a puppy, and all he wants to do is save the puppy. And wood? What do they use for a backdrop for forestry? They will find the biggest clear cut they can find on Vancouver Island. You can see the sucker from the moon. And with a tree falling into a sea of stumps, they tell people that's forestry. And if they want to talk to somebody, who do they get? They get some knuckle-dragging Neanderthal from Oregon with snooze dribbling down his chin. He says, God, I like to make stumps, and he's wearing an Eat a Owl t-shirt. That's our guy. I wish he'd stay home. Or they get a three-piece suit and tie from Weyerhaeuser, and in front of a 30-story building in downtown Seattle, he says, America wants wood fiber, and by God, we provide it. And the guy who doesn't like us, they get a pristine mountain scene with a babbling brook. With the flag in one hand, bald eagle in the other, all they want is. And we see that over and over and over again. It makes us angry. Because we know that those aren't the choices. That's preserve or destroy. Somewhere in between is conservation, what we rely on to provide for humans and protect the environment. Those aren't the choices, but does society understand that? They are three. Generations, fully three generations removed from the farm. They don't know where their stuff comes from. They have no idea. And we've laughed at them. How many of you said the stupid people in Vancouver think milk comes from a carton at Safeway? Boards just show up at Home Depot, and on sale day, a bunch of boards show up. And we kind of laugh at them because we don't think we have many legs up on our urban cousins, but we know where their stuff comes from. It's not funny. They're rightfully concerned about the environment, and they make a very fertile marketplace for those that are marketing fear. And we played into them. We didn't understand how that all worked, and we made them a lot of money. What we didn't understand is that the real enemy is ignorance. The public's ignorance of who we are and what we do for them, and our ignorance of the process of leading this discussion, not just fighting it. And the public's ignorance, think about it. How many of you have friends in Vancouver? or Calgary or Edmonton. We all know that they're smart people, aren't they? Trying to make tough decisions. They have no idea what you're doing out here. You want to protect the environment, though. They'd love to protect the forest. Put yourself in their shoes for just a minute. If you lived in a 30-story high-rise in downtown Vancouver, and you had one functioning brain cell, why, you'd move. No, that's not nice. Thankfully, they like to live there, but here's intelligent people looking at these two choices. Which would you pick if you were them? Would you pick the clear cut you can see from the moon or the pristine mountain scene? They're making the right choice. They've just been given the wrong things to choose from. And that illuminates our real problem. It is ignorance. So how do we address it? Well, the public, they just need three things. They need the truth, warts, pimples, and all. They need to have that from somebody they trust, and they need transparency. They want to be able to come out and witness it themselves. We provide those three things to them, and we can start talking about our social license with them. And boy, do we have some truth to share with them, because they have been led to believe that we are a sunset industry, that the forest landscape is going to be gone. If we were giving license, we'd destroy it. Good heavens, do we have some good news about forestry to talk to them about? I know down in the States, most people don't know we have more forests now than we did at the turn of the last century. It's because of production agriculture. They're growing more food on less acres than the acres that they used to try to grow corn and cotton on that was marginal. It's now gone back to what nature wanted, and in most cases, that's trees. We have more trees. We plant more than we harvest now. We have a great story to tell. We didn't start. No, we've got to learn how to lead. And for far too long, we fought. When we had 1,000 people in Castle Guard, we were in the middle of the fight. And we did some stupid things. Some of our early thoughts when we were in this early timber war, at first we thought, well, crazy happened. They invented crazy in California, in fact, but it could never happen here. That's what we thought. Well, crazy is transferable, we learned. Then we thought it was a pendulum thing. Any of you ever thought that? Yeah, it swung way over there with society, but it'll swing back to the middle in time. No, this is not a pendulum thing that's going to find its own middle. It's a permanent movement to the crazy marker unless we assist in finding a middle. Then we thought, well, our jobs matter. You know what? The people in Vancouver don't care about your job. If your job is going to take away their forest, then you're a necessary casualty. They care about their job and their environment. They don't care about our jobs. Then we thought, well, it's our association's jobs. You just became members of, many of you, associate members of this association so that they can take care of this crap for you. I belong to the Montana Logging Association. We go to a quarterly meeting and ask Keith Olson how the hell things are going. We saddle our associations with the impossible task of representing us without us being fully weighed in. Then we thought, well, the truth will win. Well, we've got the truth on our side. The truth without a champion does no one any good. And it has to be a champion that the public believes and trusts in. So then we started standing on street corners and shouting our truth. By God, we've got some reality they need to understand. We were shouting at the people, and I call it reverse jeopardy. We were answering all the questions they weren't asking. We needed to listen, and we didn't. We were too busy telling them what we needed them to think, when we should have been asking them what they wanted to know. We were telling them what we wanted them to know. Okay, so then we sued the bastards. We actually won some of our early lawsuits. It took us a while to figure out that we might have been winning in the court of law, but we were losing in the court of public opinion. And ultimately, the court of public opinion defines the court of law. So when that started going south, we hit the streets. That was the convoys down I-5. I was standing with 10,000 loggers in Victoria. We were thinking about replanting the lawn at the Capitol building because it had been a clear cut way too long. We had 15,000 loggers in downtown Portland. I was the guy in the lead truck in the convoys, and I was the guy with the bullhorn in the crowds, until we figured out that we were the third ring of a three-ring circus, and somebody else was taking the gate receipts. We were the perfect foil for the conflict industry that needed their story driven to the front page of USA Today, where they could ask America, you want the marching Neanderthals to whack all the trees down, or would you like to send us $20 and we'll save the forest? We were part of their business strategy. So we backed up and we started taking stock. We were fighting, but we weren't leading. And we finally decided we needed to listen to the public. And what did the public want? They wanted a healthy forest. I'll be darned. And a healthy forest is something we could get behind. That's what we want too. So we started developing the framework. We developed a vision document that, by the way, was supported by our local governments first, then our local chambers of commerce, and it ultimately ended up getting transferred into a healthy forest initiative. We started talking to the public about what they wanted. They wanted a healthy forest. Could we help them with that? Dang right we could. We also stopped talking about board feet. We stopped talking about the commodities. They didn't understand it. They didn't know where it came from. And that was associated with our job. What they wanted was simple, a healthy forest. And we got the Healthy Forest Initiative passed. It was the most progressive forest legislation in our country since Teddy Roosevelt. George Bush signed it into law. And what it does is it sets the framework. We're a long ways from getting to the end, but it's the light at the end of the tunnel for us down in the States on public land. Because we want the same thing the public does, and what do you know? We're probably gonna have to start a chainsaw. And what do you know, when we're done making the forest healthy, some commodities are gonna fall out the other end that we can send to the appropriate mill. So it is the light at the end of our tunnel. It took us a while to get there. And interestingly enough, it was like a Fort McMurray that helped us get it passed. Wayne, you remember that? It was kind of ugly. The Healthy Forest Initiative got stuck in Washington, D.C. in the Senate, and it got stuck in September. Do you remember the fires down in San Diego? It was stuck in the Senate. Nobody was moving on it. Senator Boxer and Senator Feinstein from California weren't on board yet. But then San Diego caught on fire. You want to change politics, I'll tell you what. You get a million people standing on their million-dollar home with a $6 hose going, this sucks! The politics of forestry changed overnight. We got the thing passed, and it is our hope. While we were doing that, we learned some things. And if you forget everything else I talked about tonight, these are the three things we learned the hard way. First thing we learned, democracy works, but it's not a spectator sport. We had to get engaged in the process. We had to support those who support us. Can you raise the hand to the folks that are in an elected position again? Thank you guys very, very much. Getting elected to office isn't for everybody, but supporting those who are in office that understand our truths is a job for everyone. I don't know when your last election was. We're having elections down in the States right now. And our presidential election, that really is a spectator sport. Buy some popcorn stock. I'll tell you what, the debates are going to be killer. How many of you have ever had somebody's name on your bumper, though? Somebody running for office, how many of you have ever had their name on your bumper? How many of you have ever had the name of somebody running for office pounded in your yard? There's a couple hands, good for you. We have to ask ourselves, if we aren't willing to do something like that, how do we have the gall to ask somebody in a political office to climb out on a political limb with the illumination of the media? If we won't stand for them, why should they stand with us? We need to understand the democratic process. And these folks need to understand that there is a support group out there that's going to applaud tough decisions and hold them accountable for bad ones. They need to know that we're there. We're there for them. Registering to vote, giving people time off in your plant to go vote, that it's that important. They need to know that there's a constituency that's going to applaud the courage it's going to take to get the policy you need to save your small independent mills. They need to know you're there. I particularly know this because my oldest boy, Chas, wanted to be a logger. Went to Oregon State University. His second year there, they told him they would only guarantee placement upon graduation if he had two foreign languages. They strongly suggested Russian and Portuguese. That told him Siberia and the Amazon. So he quit school, came home, logged for a year, and then went to the University of Montana. I got a degree in political science with a minor in forestry and communications. He's been elected 3 times our state representative. He is currently ending his 2nd term as our state senator. The kid and his generation are in Helena kicking butt right now, understanding how the process works, fighting for policy. He won with 87% of the vote his last election. But we've got to stand behind that generation of leadership that we need to save our rural areas. Stand with them. And by the way, we also need to thank them, because we're good at bitching at them. I went to, we have one representative in Washington, D.C. from Montana. I went to his office one day, and over his receptionist desk was the thank you card stuck in there. And I asked him, somebody important? He said, no, that's the thank you I got last year. Holy cow! We're really good at bitching when things don't go right, but we should be just as good at calling a leader up and saying thank you. They need to know that we're there, we're watching, and we can applaud. Second truth is, when people lead, leaders follow. The leaders in this room aren't foresters, probably. They need to understand, but we need to help them with the policy that can be implemented. We need to not just bitch about what's going on, but give them solutions so that they can fight for us, and not just fight against what's happening, but fight for what we would like to have happen. Your future is going to be the product of someone's vision. If not yours, then whose? You need to talk to your leaders. And the final truth is, the world is run by those who show up. There are meetings held every day someplace in British Columbia talking about the future of the areas like this. And for too long down in the States, we'd bitch about the guys that showed up like religious zealots and were trying to deal us out of business. Why, my gosh, they're just a small percentage. They talk like they're, you know what, they've got a right to show up. We've got a responsibility to plop our butt down next to them and compare visions and see whose vision is best. Show up in those meetings, and that's why it's so important. I'm so glad the ILMA is going to have associate members, because you've got to show up at those things. And we can't be at all of them. The loggers and the mill workers can't be. But the associate members that do have a dog in this fight can show up at the meetings and listen. Come back and provide feedback on what they heard and then help construct a solution. You can show up in the editorial pages. How many of you read a letter to the editor in the last year that ticked you off? Well, kicking the dog on the way to work isn't going to help. If you let those letters to the editor go unanswered, some piano tuner from Penticton is going to be the expert on forestry. They repeat the lies often enough, it becomes the truth. So we've got to weigh in. We've got to show up in things like our Chamber of Commerce. How many of you are members of your chamber? Good for you. In logging, we didn't belong to our chamber in Libby. We'd bitch about them because all they're after is tourism and crafting. I didn't think we should belong because we don't have a shingle on Main Street. But there are business peers. We finally joined the Libby Montana Chamber of Commerce, got 60 loggers to join with us. They are the people that got the state Chamber of Commerce involved in the Healthy Forest Initiative. They got the national Chamber of Commerce involved in the Healthy Forest Initiative. And they're a large reason why we got it passed. So join your chamber. Offer to give a luncheon speech on what you're doing in forestry. Show up. I'm going to quickly go through some tips that might help. When I think about help, I'm asked lots of times, I wasn't going to do this, but I'm going to do it because you've added your associate members. What can I do to help? Well, these are the things that I think associate members and members can do to help. The H in help stands for humanize. Society's real or perceived issues must be engaged by humans and human interest terms. They want somebody they can trust. That's over the backyard fence type of stuff. They trust you, their neighbor. So they need a human, not some three-piece suit and tie from Weyerhaeuser, but their neighbor, people in their community that they can talk to and trust, their elected leaders. We have to have a human face on this, or it's just an evil old industry. social norms have made it really easy to vilify industry, and I don't have enough time left in my life to fight that. Disney is doing a really good job there. And people still trust their neighbors. They want somebody, they hunger for somebody to trust. But we have to have a human face. The engagement also has to have ambassadors with whom there's an element of trust. That is, you associate members, your elected members. Rural cultures need a trusted human face to share the story, and that face, it's got to be yours. The E, we used to think the E in help stood for education. It doesn't. It stands first for empathy. Understand the expressed concerns of the public. What do they think are real issues, and what do they think is an acceptable solution? Because if you can't hear that, then you're going to give them answers to questions they're not asking, and they're going to give you answers that put you out of business. Listen to the public. Hear what they're saying. The message to assure the public, if you want to maintain your small independent mills in the ILMA, if you want your rural cultures to survive, the message we've got to have to the people in Vancouver is, I am listening, I understand, I respect, or maybe even share your concerns, and I'm part of the answer to those concerns. When we get there, our social license gets maintained. If we can't get there, they're going to put us out of business thinking they have to save their forest. That's the biggest thing we learned, that we need to empathize. And then we can educate. Don't play reverse jeopardy, though. Listen, so you can address their questions, their needs, their concerns. And we need to learn how to address those concerns in English. That means don't throw a white paper at them. They don't know what basal area per acre means. But they want to know, is my forest going to be healthy? Is the water going to be clean? Is the ecosystem going to be whole? Give it to them in English in their terms. And we need to watch our language. It's really easy to cuss the bastards. But you know what? Those bastards are the majority of society. There are people concerned about the environment. Don't curse environmentalists. Offer to be their leader. That's the winning hand. They are concerned about the environment. So are we. They're not going to endorse someone that's anti-environment. They should not. We've got to watch how we talk about them and their concerns. And boy, I'm telling you this because I was guilty of all this stuff. We've got to watch how we talk. And finally, lead locally. Don't worry about Vancouver right now. Right now, worry about Nelson and Castlegar and Fruitvale and Cranbrook, that's outside your area. Share your story and your truths with local media, local business peers, local civic groups, local schools, and your local leaders. Worry about home first, because that is our last line of defense. And particularly, I see a lot of folks in here that are under like 35 years old. Leaving our communities are a lot of young adults, and some of them are choosing to go to the city because they found economic employment or they just like the city. They need to, when they leave here, they need to be ambassadors for the truth. Because if we don't engage our local folks and they leave here, they go back and they think they know what they're talking about. And one of the biggest problems we have in Libby, Montana is a guy who says he's a logger. He couldn't log a weenie out of a Safeway store. But he's an expert because he came from a logging area. Well, bullshit. So don't lose home. Focus on it first, and then we can work on the other areas. And I brought a little thing about schools. Dwayne Goggin is here. He'll recognize Kettle Falls Elementary School. You guys know where Kettle Falls is, little? Well, a guy sent me this a few years ago as I was worried about how we were going to teach the kids in Chicago and stuff. And he sent me this, and it jerked my chain, I'll tell you what. It's a dinosaur test that was given to students all across the United States. 5 questions on dinosaurs, second graders. Where did dinosaurs live? Circle the right habitat. Which was the meat eater? Circle the right little dinosaur. Which helped dinosaurs catch food? Circle the right little rodent. Which way do people endanger animals? Kid with the goat, girl with the cat, ponies in a pen, or the logger? Question number 5, which person is learning about dinosaurs? Circle the right scientist. I'm a logger, so I'm overly sensitive, but this is a dinosaur test. And it's dinosaur, 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 bash the logger, dinosaur. And the guy who sent this to me had two problems. Number one, it shouldn't have been in a national scholastic test for second graders anywhere, but particularly in his home. And his little girl circled the logger and got "good job" written at the top by her teacher. And the P in help stands for participate. What I ask folks to do is add a line item to their business plan for activism. And I know that doesn't sound like a lot of fun. Rural people, we kind of have a negative reaction to activism. When I told my dad we had to become activists, I got the look from him that I just got from you. He was welding on a dozer, it was springtime. Jasper Carlton with the Fund for Animals out of Boulder had just shut down a third of our forest, and it was front page news. And I went out into the shop and I said, "Hey, Father Old Person." He flipped his welding helmet up, I could still see the smoking rod in his hand, and I said, "Dad, if we're gonna survive, we're gonna have to become activists." He gave me your look. He was thinking, "Grow hair to my butt and smoke pot? How's that? Maybe we ought to just have the auction, you know?" Activism isn't marching in the streets. Activism is taking 1 hour a week to go to a civic group and talk about your culture, your industry, going to the Chamber of Commerce, going into a school, calling a leader and talking to them. 1 hour a week doing something to advocate for your culture and your town. That's what activism is about, and it ought to be part of doing business. Don't take it out of family, don't take it out of church, don't take it out of school. It's part of being in business. Tools that can work, the political process works, but you gotta offer solutions, not just bitch about how it's going. Real conservation initiatives do work. Join them, own them. Telegraph the fact that you belong to them. Sustainable forestry, own it. Tours and open houses, do you guys give them? I saw that, they work. Welcome wagons, how many of you bitched about the people from Vancouver moving out here when they retire? My wife is from San Jose, California. The first stop she made when we moved back to Montana was the courthouse to get rid of her driver's license. We give people that move into our rural areas a bunch of crap until the week after they're dead. They're outsiders after all. So we treat them like the enemy. They congeal into peer groups and they become the enemy because they don't know what makes this area tick. They just fell in love with it. In the old days, we weren't that way. In the old days, when new people came to town, we met them with the pie. It was new blood, new ideas, somebody besides a cousin to marry our daughter. Here's the pie. And can you stop them from moving here? No. So greet them. Tell them you understand why they moved here. Yes, it's beautiful. Then explain the history of the area. And explain how the area looks like this, partially because of the timber industry. And talk to them about your hopeful future. Bring them in. Don't treat them like the enemy or they will become the enemy. Earth Day. How many of you have ever celebrated Earth Day? I asked Louisiana Pacific 1 year if they spent any money on Earth Day, and they said, "Yeah, about $500,000 a year." And I said, "On what?" And they said, "Increased security." You know? Earth Day should be a celebration. Own it in your rural timber town to celebrate how far we've come. Do we have mountains to climb yet? Absolutely. But it ought to be a celebration of the goals that we've already reached and setting new ones for ourselves. Own that sucker. Social media, that's the new backyard fence. We can now punch one button and talk to 500 friends all over the country. Use it. And if you don't know how to use it, you've got a member of your family, in my case, it's my wife, that knows how. Use that stuff. Did you know campaigns? Associate members and elected folks? Towns can have a did you know about forestry. Do you guys remember that I am Boyd? Little tiny clip in papers that had little factoids. People love factoids. Run a little did you know campaign to constantly feed the public about the truth about forestry in your area. And school engagement. Go into the classroom. They're hungry for information from real people. Don't just send them a box of Project Learning Tree where they can dig through and find the stuff to misuse against us. Carry the sucker in there and introduce yourself. It works. I'm going to end with a message about hope. We have a long ways to go before we save our social license. Before you save the 9 independent mills that are here, there's a lot of work to be done. But I do have more hope now than I used to. And part of it is because society is ready. And some of that in forestry is because of the fires in Kelowna, the fires in the West Coast, the fires in Fort McMurray this year. Some of that is generating that, and some of it is just people being tired. They're tired of hearing what's wrong and ready to start hearing about what can be right. They're tired of the doom and gloom, bongo drum beating, incense burning, planet is dying crap that they've been getting since they were 5. They've been told 3 times their skin's gonna fall off in 12 years. They're exhausted. And then we want them to recycle a can, bite it. They want a new message. And I particularly know because of the next generation. I got a call a couple years ago from the University of Illinois. The student president asked if I'd come talk to the kids on Earth Day. I thought, you want a logger on, you're looking for somebody to kill, aren't you? And I went, 3,000 kids in the auditorium. They looked me up on the internet. There were picketers in the back of the room calling me some pretty fun names. But I talked to them about the same kind of thing as we just talked about. I talked about how the old environmental movement was timely and necessary, but failed to mature beyond a 3-word vision of stop doing that. And when they were sharing planet Earth with 9 to 11 billion other souls, stop doing that wasn't going to cut it. We need a new environmental vision built on hope instead of fear, science instead of emotion, education instead of litigation, resolution instead of conflict, and employing rather than destroying human resources. And that new movement's gonna be led by rural people because we live too close to the ground to pretend. And I still get goosebumps because those kids stood up and they clapped and they stomped and they whistled and they escorted the picketers out of the back of the auditorium. And I asked the president, I said, what happened? But I told him, I thought my job here today was to get tomatoed off stage. His direct quote was, we are tired of hearing that the planet your generation is handing us is a piece of crap. You gave us hope. The next stop was Dartmouth. Same reaction from the kids. It was an Earth Day swing. The next stop was Brown, Ted Turner's alma mater, not a bastion of conservative thought. Same reaction from the kids. Now I go all over the country, Canada and the United States, at the request of the next generation. They're starving for a message of hope. They will not, they should not endorse an anti-environmental message, but they want a new one. They want a new leader of this discussion, a leader that can give them hope about the planet we're handing off to them. And that gives me a lot of hope. We also have a program in the States called Provider Pals. We've done it up in British Columbia as well. I go into a school, talk to the kids. Schools all over both of our countries are hungry to have a real person come into class. I'm not going to go into it right now. I'll tell you, it started because I went into a school in Cedar Lake, Montana, a logging town, talked to the kids about being a logger. On the way out the door, the teacher said, that was awesome, and it was also timely, because tomorrow Louisa Wilcox is bringing in a wolf, and the kids are going to adopt it, name it, and track it for a year. I thought, oh, crap. Louisa Wilcox is with Earth Justice, the Sierra Club's legal arm, and I knew she wasn't just bringing a wolf into fifth graders. She was bringing politics into a classroom. On the way out the door, after the kids named the wolf Alfred, she's going to say, oh, by the way, logging's bad for Alfred, farming's bad for Alfred. I knew the mantra. So I had 220 miles of windshield time to ponder what I call charismatic megafauna. When the conflict industry wants to beat the snot out of rural areas, they humanize nature and vilify humans. That's how we ended up with Flipper the Dolphin and Willie the Whale and Warm and Fuzzy Spotted Owl. What do we have? The only thing I could come up with is we have us. So when I got home, I called the teacher up and I said, I think in school you're adopting a wolf. How would you like to adopt a logger? There was dead silence on the other end. And I already got a name and everything. Don't have to do that. So the kids adopted me. They tracked me for a year. And then on Earth Day, I went back to the school. And all I did was talk to them about our culture. And it went so well, the teachers said, could we adopt like a farmer and a rancher and somebody else who provides stuff? And in that little town of 700 that is just a sawmill, a program got started that's now in New York City and Los Angeles and Minneapolis, St. Paul and Detroit and The next generation is starting to hear from us. And by the way, the questions they have of people like you, it's not parts per million, basal area per acre. It's really tough questions like, how big's your truck? Have you ever been chased by a bear? Do you have any scars I can look at? They want to know, who are we? And then they want to touch us. We also have a lot to learn about them. The first logger that got adopted in New York City, they didn't have a playground. They had 50-story buildings and a rooftop, and when the bell rang, 100 kids and teachers climbed out onto the roof and played. When the bell rang again, they'd climb back in the building and 100 more kids would climb out onto the roof. That doesn't look like Nelson. We had a farmer, rancher, miner, logger. We were gold panning. We were doing bread in a bag. We were cutting tree cookies with a chainsaw and roping a plastic dummy head on the roof. It was awesome. But at the end of the day, I was flying to Los Angeles for the next school, and the logger called me, and he was on his way back to Montana, and said, bad news. So what's that? He said, I left the chainsaw on the roof. So well, that sucks. He said, yeah, it's probably hawked already. Like there's a market for chainsaws. And now they might be holding hands around doing kumbayas, but I bet they haven't touched it. There was a wheat farmer from the Palouse that was still in New York, and I called Mike up and said, could you go get the chainsaw? Chas left the chainsaw on the roof and said, yeah, I'm just 15 blocks away, I'll go get it. He called me that night and said, mission accomplished. You've never lived. You've tried to hail a cab in Manhattan with the chainsaw. Oh, taxi! We have a lot to learn about their realities. Our culture doesn't look like theirs. Look at the demographics of this room and then think about the demographics of Canada, the social body that you have to get your license from. We don't even look like the rest of our country. We need to understand them, and they want us to build that bridge. They're hungry for the bridge. I'll close with a cultural plea. This is all the reason I was excited, and I'm excited for the ILMA getting associate members, and I'm excited you're doing this before it's too late. You're gathering your leaders, your community leaders, your opinion leaders, because what's at stake here is more than just business. The question is, are we going to have a culture of production? And when my butt gets tired, I think about what happened to that guy that I have promised won't happen to another generation in our family. Because the culture has been under siege for as long as the industry has been. I was in the third grade in Libby, Montana, when we took a test called the Iowa Basics Test. Everybody in the States takes it. It's a test to tell how smart or dumb your kids are. And when the principal and teacher got the results in, they called mom and dad into school. And I laid awake waiting for him to get home that night, because when the principal calls dad, life, as you know, it's about to come to a screaming halt, so I was awake. We lived in a trailer at that time, had really thin walls. Dad didn't know for over 30 years that I overheard the conversation, but I did. And it impacts me more now than it did even then, because I understand the message better. What they talked about in our little living room in our timber town was how to keep me from being a logger. Because my dad had been told that night that if I ended up being a logger, it was his fault. And he got the message. He was told that I had scored high on the Iowa Basics test, and I was going to be too smart to be a dumb old logger like him. And for the first time in that proud man's life, instead of looking down at his hands and seeing calluses on his palm and dirt under his fingernails, and that being a source of pride, because it built our company, it built our town, it built our state, it built our bloody nation, for the first time in his life, it was a source of shame and guilt. He had a heritage that wasn't worthy of passing on, at least to intelligent children. And he wrapped that misplaced mantle of guilt around his neck and wore it for decades. And I can tell you, when we put him in the ground a couple of years ago, I pray the mantle was gone. Because I got to work with him. I got to work with him for almost 40 years. I can tell you, when we were standing out in the forest, looking at a hillside of trees, trying to figure out how to apply modern forest management to that hillside. I have 2 degrees hanging on my wall. He didn't have a one, and there was a stupid person standing there. It was not my father. He had more sustainable environmental information in his brain that came to him through his hands than he could have gotten with a doctorate degree from Yale. But he learned by doing. For some reason, society has decided to discount that knowledge base. They continue the discount at their own peril. I'm a big believer in higher education. I have four kids, they have all completed college. But when they left the University of Montana, they left fully understanding that all the theory taught in our universities is just that. It's theory. And it floats around in non-la land until some real person takes it to the real world and tries to apply it with their real hands. And what's at stake in this discussion is that laboratory of application. Because what happens if the leading export of our interior area in Montana is young, well-educated, well-rounded children? We can be left with Scary Larry and his idiot brother in a 1952 John Deere tractor trying to do what? We need our smart kids back. We need our smart kids in our forests, in our fields. It's going to take really creative kids doing really creative things to feed and clothe 11 billion people and save the planet. And for me, that's what it's about. I have grandkids. And if they want to come back and take the flag of Vincent logging and try to figure out how to take it into the next century, they're going to do it without a social class head trip. We have a heritage that we are proud of, we have a right to be proud of, and we have a future that we're excited about. That's what keeps my fire going. I'm going to leave you with what Mom left. When Mom checked out, she knew that I had a tendency to try to eat elephants. So after tomorrow, you're going to learn a lot of stuff. I've seen your agenda. I wish I could stay for some really cool stuff. When you leave here, you're going to have a lot of stuff, a lot of information. What I ask you to do is commit to doing something. 1 hour a week of activism, doing something. And since I try to eat elephants, Mom left me this, and I leave you with it. It is from numberless diverse acts of courage and belief that human history is shaped. Each time a man stands up for an ideal or acts to improve the lot of others or strikes out against injustice, he sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. And crossing each other from a million different centers of energy and daring, those ripples build a current that can sweep down the mightiest walls of oppression and resistance. That's Bobby Kennedy, South Africa, 1966. It's also ILMA, 2016, Nelson, B.C. You don't have to go home and try to be a wave. You've got to make a living, you've got a family to take care of, but you have got to leave here committed to being a ripple. And together, you'll make a wave. There's a way to save the last best places. It's just going to take the last best people standing together to do it. This logger from Libby couldn't be proud to stand here with you. Thanks.